It's my pleasure to welcome and introduce Sunil Amrith. Some of you might have been there for the previous talk that he gave here, but that's almost 2 years ago, so I imagine there's been a huge turnover of people. It's a pleasure to welcome Sunil for a couple of reasons. One being, of course, it's always good to have a good friend and colleague come and speak about some work which excites you, but it's also probably one of the last times it's going to be easy to get him here. Sunil is a reader at Birkbeck College, and in July this year he will join Harvard as full professor in modern history. Among Sunil's earlier works, and let me read out the titles to you to sort of get the full import of what I'll say after that. So his first book was called Decolonizing International Health, India and Southeast Asia, 1930 to 1965. His second book, which came for about 4.5 years after that, was called Migration and Diaspora in Modern Asia, followed by a publication, well, I would have said last year, but it's 2013, so I guess, but still, it's about a year, a little over a year ago, called Crossing the Bay of Bengal, The Furies of Nature and the Fortunes of Migrants. So judging from the range of topics that he's covered, he would be fully qualified now to even get a German professorship. Forget, you know, the Harvard, having been traversed across centuries and a diversity of topics. Especially important, I think, for us as scholars, or many of us who are trying to work on India, is his most recent book, which, according to many, has transformed the frameworks for looking at history of modern India, but also modern Asia, some of which he'll be discussing, and I'm guessing he'll be open to questions about the frameworks and its import to doing further work in the later half of the session when we ask him more and more questions. So welcome, Sunil, and we look forward to what you have to say.
Thank you so much, Janavi. Thank you very much for having me. I'd like to talk this evening about a region which the conventional definition of South Asia allows little room for. That's an oceanic region that stretched across the Bay of Bengal, linking India's eastern coast with island and mainland Southeast Asia. In the tradition of area studies, the boundary between South and Southeast Asian studies was always drawn in the east, where Burma meets India and Bangladesh. And this was essentially a line right down the middle of the Bay of Bengal. But even in the heyday of this area studies tradition, when those boundaries were drawn most rigidly, I think these inter-regional connections lurked in the shadows of different kinds of scholarship. I've become more and more aware, for example, of how important Southeast Asia is to the classic works on South Indian economic and agrarian history. Dharma Kumar's classic work of the 1960s, Chris Baker's Agrarian History of South India, written in the 1980s, had a lot to say about Southeast Asia, even though it was, so to speak, waiting in the wings or not quite center stage. But these connections are clear, too, in the tradition of work on plantation labor in Malaya, in immigration to Burma, and yet, nevertheless, these histories have been studied by and large separately and by very different groups of scholars. My basic contention this evening and in my recent book is that the Bay of Bengal is a meaningful historical region, that at particular moments, and especially between the mid-19th and the mid-20th centuries, its coasts were as closely linked to each other as they were to the heartlands of the nation-states that they eventually formed part of. My research has been motivated for a long time by the desire to break that particular boundary between the study of South and Southeast Asia, which is still, I think, quite firmly entrenched in the academy, but also in the structure of regional institutions. If you think of ASEAN and SAARC, they draw quite a clear boundary between what is South Asia and what is Southeast Asia. This longer history appears in my recent book, which Janavi mentioned, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, which goes back to the 18th century and comes up to the present day. But this evening I would actually like to focus on the period of what I see as the most intensive connectedness in that region, which is the 1920s and 30s. I'm talking about a region that was linked neither by a single language, nor really by political integration, though most of it was within the British Empire. Rather, it was a region defined by mobility and circulation. That is to say, by the movement of people, migration on an enormous scale, the movement of ideas, the movement of capital. And the core problem I want to address tonight, and hopefully in much more detail in the question and answer afterwards, is how and why this region, which was so intensively connected by the 1920s, collapsed so rapidly and seemingly without a trace, to such an extent that I think it was quite reasonable for scholars sitting down to think of South Asia in 1965, or even in the early 1990s, to pay it no attention. Which is why I've called this a story of the decline of a South Asian region, though I'll suggest towards the end that that decline was perhaps not the complete rupture that it might initially seem. Needless to say, the Bay of Bengal had been a space of commercial exchange and small-scale migration for centuries, a maritime space that was relatively easy to cross because of the pattern of the monsoon winds, and an arena for the competition of European empires from the time of the Portuguese conquest of Malacca. But it was in the second half of the 19th century that that connectedness underwent a fundamental change in scale. As the British Empire expanded east to encompass most of the Bay of Bengal's coasts, with the exception, of course, of Siam and Sumatra. The Bay was reformed as a region at the heart of the imperial economy, integrated by the force of capital in search of new profits on Southeast Asia's forest frontiers. The steamship technological change made the ocean crossing faster, cheaper, and easier than ever before. But this was a space governed by imperial laws that both uprooted and immobilized people, locking some communities in place as peasants while compelling others to travel either under contracts of indenture or under the weight of debt. And I think mobility and immobility are entwined throughout this story, including in its later stages. The impact of these transformations is difficult to exaggerate. The Bay of Bengal's circuits of migration and the transformation of its ecology responded to and fueled change on a global scale. Just remember that Malayan rubber, tapped almost entirely by Tamil migrant workers, fed the American automobile industry with 80% of its supply in the 1920s. Malaya became the most economically valuable tropical colony in the whole of the British Empire. Burma became the largest rice exporter in the world in a boom that was backed by Indian capital and drew millions of Indian migrant workers into every sector of its economy. I was told the screen is not very good in this room, so I don't have pictures, but I'll just pass this one map around. And that's a shipping map from the turn of the 20th century, which shows passenger shipping routes across the Bay of Bengal. These were run by the British India Steam Navigation Company. And you can see from that network of crisscross lines, and this is actually from the archives of the National Maritime Museum, just how intensely connected that space was. One of the things that's striking is that it's two maps overlaid one on top of the other, in the sense that the older pre-colonial ports still appear on those maps. They are still connected by small feeder services and coastal shipping into what had emerged as the large ports of overseas migration, above all Madras and Nagapattinam, and to a lesser extent, Calcutta. So in these decades between the 1880s and the 1930s, the Bay of Bengal became home to one of the world's great migrations, and one that has been far less discussed than transatlantic or even Chinese migration. The vast majority of this movement was back and forth between India and just three destinations, Burma, Ceylon, and Malaya. At the absolute peak of migration, which came in 1926 and 1927, over 150,000 people arrived in Malaya from Indian ports. 285,000 arrived in Ceylon, and the number of arrivals in Burma was even greater, exceeding 400,000 people every year from 1926 to 1929. No other part of the Indian Ocean experienced migration on anything like the scale of the Bay of Bengal. The distinctive characteristic of this migration, though, was its circularity. Until the 1930s, between 70 and 80% of those who traveled out from India returned to India within 3 to 7 years. As such, the shipping records counting arrivals and departures are very likely to be counting the same individuals several times as they moved back and forth. Many people would have two or three stints of labor in Malaya over the course of, say, 20 years in the 20s and 30s. At the same time, of course, mortality rates, especially on the plantations of Malaya, were astonishingly high in the 1870s and 80s and continued to be high well into the 20th century. So, of course, many who made the journey out never returned because they died overseas. The numbers who moved to settle in Southeast Asia, that is to say, were limited, and this is perhaps one reason why this migration, despite its magnitude, has not received as much attention as Indian labor migration to more distant parts. Because the earlier indentured migration to sugar colonies like Mauritius, Fiji, Natal tended to be permanent movements, the figures of net migration make them seem much more comparable to migration around the bay than, in fact, I think they were. I'll stay with the demography for a moment to try to develop this argument that the Bay of Bengal was a vital South Asian region in the years between the wars. Every year, the number of people making the journey from eastern Indian ports to Ceylon, Burma, and Malaya outstripped the number of people traveling from Madras Presidency to any other port in British India. The contrast with Western India was very significant because there the majority of seaborne journeys were intra-provincial, from one port of Bombay Presidency to another. In Madras, the overwhelming majority of ship journeys were to other parts of the British Empire in Asia. So there's a sharp contrast between the Bay of Bengal and the Arabian Sea in terms of the importance of long distance versus coastal shipping. Indeed, there is a sense in which the urbanization of South India is actually incomplete as a story without the port cities of Southeast Asia. Rangoon, to take an example, was for all intents and purposes an Indian city by the early 20th century. Over 70% of Rangoon's population was India-born. On some calculations, Rangoon was the second largest port of immigration and emigration in the entire world after New York City by the late 1920s, something that can be very difficult to imagine indeed in contemporary Rangoon, despite its recent vitality and its reconnection with the region. All of Rangoon's sweepers, night soil removers, virtually every rickshaw puller was a migrant from South India. In fact, the majority of them were from the Telugu-speaking districts of Madras, that is, present-day Andhra. On the docks, in the factories, on the streets, in the offices, migrants from India, most of them on short-term contracts, provided the bulk of Rangoon's labor. On a visit to Rangoon in 1916, Rabindranath Tagore observed, "The city of Rangoon is not a city of Burma. It appears to stand in opposition to the entire country. This city has not grown like a tree from the soil of the country." Those words would prove prophetic in terms of the violence, the intercommunal violence that took place in Rangoon in the 1930s. Rangoon was by this point, as I've suggested, one of the largest ports of immigration in all the world. But Singapore, Penang, and Colombo too hosted very large numbers of South Indian migrant workers, in a very wide range of occupations, as shopkeepers, as road builders, as colonial civil servants. Over 100,000 Indian migrants were present in Rangoon in the 1920s. Over 100,000 in Malaya and the Straits settlements concentrated in Singapore and Penang. And this is what really struck me. The Madras-born populations of Rangoon, Singapore, Penang, and Colombo was greater than the overall population of most towns in South India. Only Madras, Madurai, and arguably Coimbatore had in excess of 100,000 total population in the 1930s, whereas the Madras-born population of each of the colonial port cities in Southeast Asia exceeded that level. And bear in mind that the Madras-born population of each of those Southeast Asian port cities was also significantly greater than the South Indian population in any Indian city outside Madras Presidency, including, by quite a margin, Bombay. That is to say, many parts of South India were more closely and intensively connected to the other side of the Bay of Bengal than to the economic and political heartlands of the Indian subcontinent. It's only in the 40s and 50s that that pattern fundamentally shifts when you get mass migration from Madras to Bombay, for example. This alone, I think, makes the Bay of Bengal's neglect in modern South Asian history puzzling. But beneath the demographic and economic connections, The bay was also an imaginative and a cultural space, and that is what I'd like to go on to talk about now. Thinking about that inner history of the Bay of Bengal, what lay beneath those lines on the map, allows us to see it as a world linked by ideas and words and kinship as much as by capital and labor. Let me give you one example of what I mean by that. It's not difficult to imagine the Bay of Bengal as a web of printing presses. As Ronit Ritchie has shown in her wonderful work, the very first Malay language newspaper anywhere in the world was published not in Malaya, but in Sri Lanka, by the long settled Malay community there. Similarly, some of the earliest Tamil language newspapers came not from Madras or the Muslim towns of the Tamil coast, but from Singapore and Penang and Colombo. The very first Malay language newspaper published in the Straits Settlements, Jawi Peranakan, was started by the same publishing house as its first Tamil newspaper. The press was owned by a family of mixed Malay and Tamil ethnicity. And this geography of the Tamil cultural world remained very fluid well into the 20th century. This is clear from the varied cultural horizons of Singapore's Tamil press in the 20s and 30s. Founded by a character called G. Sarangapani, who's a very interesting figure, he moved to Singapore in the early 20s to work as a clerk in a Muslim merchant shop, ended up as a journalist, and he ended up founding the two newspapers, Munnetram and Tamil Murasa, that remained the major newspapers. Tamil Murasa is still the main Tamil language newspaper in Singapore to this day. And his papers were sites of cultural debate and experiment. They tried to enact in Singapore and Penang the social and caste reform of Periyar E.V. Ramasamy's self-respect movement following his visit to Malaya in 1929. Newspapers addressed and in the process they created new publics. Their debates, their readership crossed colonial and national borders, and you can see this just from the lists of subscribers for each of these newspapers, many of which were quite short-lived, their runs of only 1 or 2 years before they go bankrupt. Benedict Anderson's classic analysis, of course, of the role of the daily newspaper in forging national consciousness remains a touchstone. But in the waters of the Bay of Bengal, his assumption that the only imagined community was a nation seems deeply misplaced. The vernacular press in urban Southeast Asia spoke of and addressed many imagined communities, appealing to constituencies defined in local, regional, religious, and linguistic terms, which were not always mutually exclusive. Consider for a moment the specific terms that these Tamil newspapers used to describe the world they wrote about and the audiences they addressed. They used the terms Indians overseas, South Indian coolies, the Tamil world, Indians in Malaya, Indians in the empire. These terms all appeared frequently, sometimes interchangeably, but each drew different boundaries around community. Each evoked a slightly different sense of geography. The awareness of being part of an imperial labor diaspora, for example, was balanced against a more specific sense of a Tamil-speaking world connecting India and Southeast Asia. But the Tamil newspapers also engaged in vigorous debate with the local Malay press over rights and indigeneity, with Chinese social reformers over superstition and social reform, with colonial officials over sanitation and public space and migration policy. And these newspapers were vehicles of commercial advertising as much as anything else. To use the slightly anachronistic terms, brands circulated around the Bay of Bengal, as well as people, texts, and newspapers. Interestingly enough, one of the first people to write explicitly of a Tamil diaspora in the world was an English clergyman, Norman Sargent. He began his 1941 book on the dispersion of the Tamil church with a quotation from the book of Ezekiel that evokes the original sense of the term diaspora. My sheep were scattered upon all the face of the earth. Sargent described the Tamil people of the dispersion, and that's the earliest use I've seen of that phrase, as he wrote of the small churches that they'd established in Ceylon and Burma and Malaya and further afield. It has been said that the dispersion of the Jews was a preparation for Christianity in the ancient world, he wrote, hopefully. May it also be said that the dispersion of the Tamil church was of great help to the apostles of the 19th century. Tamil Christians were, of course, but a small minority among those who crossed the Bay of Bengal, though I think their story remains understudied and is very fascinating. But Sargent sensed that the Tamil diaspora was best charted by its spiritual journeys, might have shared resonance by many Hindus and Muslims who crossed the water too. And this brings me to my second sense in which I think the Bay of Bengal emerged as an imaginative space. It was for many a sacred space. As migrant labor transformed the Bay of Bengal as a region, it also expanded the Tamil or Chinese or Malay spatial and cultural imagination. This is reflected in the Hindu shrines that sprouted up on every single rubber estate in the Malayan forest, many of them to Tamil village deities. They implanted a new sacred sense upon a new ecology of plantation monoculture. So many of the stories I heard collecting oral histories on Malaysia's former plantations over many years were not stories of boats and sea crossings, but stories of the land, stories about particular shrines, even of particular trees or sacred groves, right at the heart of this plantation economy. The historian of the American West, Richard White, reminds us that nature can be known through labor. And for many South Indian migrants, this is precisely how the environmental history of the Bay of Bengal was intimately connected with their experiences of migration. Climate, for instance, formed an index of displacement, a measure of how far they were from home. The sharp contrast, which you see again and again in legal records, in colonial reports, in commissions of inquiry, was between the seasonality of wet and dry seasons in South India and the year-round tropicality of the Malayan Peninsula. At the same time, it was the landscape itself through which migrants staked a claim to the land. They found a landscape that reminded them of home and built shrines upon them, first small ones and eventually large temples. And we can perhaps come back to this point later, but these sacred landscapes remain central to contemporary struggles for citizenship in Malaysia above all. The demolition of these temples that were established by that first generation of Tamil migrant workers was what was behind the massive upsurge of Tamil political protest in Malaysia in the last decade. The third, and I think in some ways the least tangible way in which I think the Bay of Bengal was an imaginative space, was as a space of kinship, as a family space. This became clear to me in trying to gain a sense of the experiences and the expectations of that generation of migrants that moved across the Bay in the 1920s and 30s, the peak decades of migration. And this was something I tried to piece together from the oral history collection of Singapore's National Archives, from stray legal sources, and from oral testimony that I gathered myself. Let me very briefly sketch three such biographies, all of whom made that journey across the Bay of Bengal for the first time in the 1920s. It was because of what he described as unbearable hunger that A.N. Maideen traveled from the Tamil weaving village of Kadainallur to Singapore in 1920, traveling with his father and four others. Arriving in Singapore, what he recalled was really the profusion of Tamil Muslims in the food business, their food stalls a site of interaction for working class men from all communities. Maideen was a regular at the Anson Road football stadium, where he said the Calcutta Gymkhana Club visited in the 1930s and Hindus and Muslims played together. But for him, the cinema above all defined the era. And the cinemas of Singapore are amongst the most polyglot in the world in the 1920s and 30s, screening films by the 1930s on a single afternoon that might have been in Chinese, Malay, a range of Indian languages, plus the latest from Hollywood. Interestingly, the first Indian film to screen in Singapore in the 1930s had its soundtrack partly in Tamil, partly in Telugu. For him, memories of a world of urban modernity prevailed over that sense of being forced to migrate by hunger. Like so many migrant testimonies, a sense of self-fashioning rather than victimhood is what comes through in his recollections, which were, of course, collected many, many years later. A second such snippet, and snippets is all we have, and one of the interesting things is that most of these migrants have little trace of their journeys, and Often their names are lost to us, let alone the details of their lives, so they drop in and out of the record, leaving only a little bit with which to reconstruct their itineraries, and even less with which to reconstruct their worldviews and their experiences. In 1937, a decade after A.N. Maydeen, Palaniswami Kumaran left the port of Nagapattinam to travel to Penang. Traveling with few possessions, Palaniswami paid 27 rupees for his place on the steamer. The worst of the depression was over by this point. Malaya's rubber plantations were picking up again. It was a freak accident, a house fire that had sent the young man to seek his fortune abroad at a time of family strife. But his destination was obvious. Lots of guys came and went from Malaya to the village, he said, so I thought I would go too, see what it was all about. And in his story, it's the importance of family networks and local connections that explains the particular trajectories that migration took by the 1930s. The other thing that is very striking about all of these mini biographies, if I may call them that, is circulation. Each of these figures made a journey to Southeast Asia at some point in the 20s and 30s and spent most of those decades circulating back and forth with absolutely no expectation of settling down in Southeast Asia until the Second World War, which changed everything. This generation's experiences of movement around the Bay of Bengal did, I think, generate what the philosopher Charles Taylor calls social imaginaries. Taylor describes social imaginaries as the particular ways that people imagine their social existence, how they fit together with others, how things go between them and their fellows, the expectations which are normally met, and the deeper normative notions and images which underlie these expectations. South Indian sojourners in Southeast Asia shared elements of this social imaginary shaped by migration across the bay. And they would have shared aspects of this imaginary, how they fit together with others, how things go between them and their fellows, with their Chinese and Malay neighbors, not to say with South Asian migrants from other parts of the subcontinent. Taylor insists, and I think he is right in this context at least, that such social imaginaries are often not expressed in theoretical terms, but carried in images, stories, and legends. They refer to a common understanding which makes possible common practices. The common practices on the streets of these port cities, practices of eating together in these Tamil Muslim food stalls, of sharing public space, of participating in each other's festivities, have had an enduring life and constitute in themselves, I think, a sort of archive of migration and interaction. But here is the twist, because perhaps the key expectation which was normally met was the expectation of mobility. This was a world in which people expected that they would move back and forth across the sea. Building out from these individual life histories, we can see these expectations of mobility embedded in the shifting demography of migration. By the 1930s, there was a rising proportion of repeat migrants. That is to say, those arriving in Malaya and Ceylon were those who already had connections there, including prior periods of labor themselves, or family connections. In the case of Ceylon in particular, the figures suggest that from the late 1920s, a significant proportion of people arriving in Ceylon had already at some point in their lives spent more than 5 years on the island. On a number of occasions in the 20s and 30s, the number of such repeat or long-term migrants outstripped the number of first-time arrivals. And you see a similar pattern starting to set in Malaya, though there a little bit later, it only happens in the 1930s. This suggests that by the 1930s, patterns of circular migration had actually established a more stable long-term character. Far from representing a simple shift from circular migration to settlement, which is the conventional narrative in migration studies, these migrants established tighter connections between their places of origin and their places of long-term labor. The development of deeper roots in Ceylon or Malaya on the part of Tamil laborers spurred rather than reducing the intensity of circular migration. Migration became a constant and repeated part of the life experiences of a substantial number of people in South India, including a much larger proportion of women than ever before. Because one of the striking things about this migration until the late 1920s is that it was overwhelmingly male. This is less true in the case of Ceylon, where family migration was common, but in Malaya and Burma, the vast majority of labor migration was single men or married men who left their families at home. That starts to change in the 1920s and 30s. By the mid-1930s, the sex ratio among Tamil rubber estate workers in Malaya was estimated at about 515 women to 1,000 men. 515 women to 1,000 men. In 1911, that figure had been just 300. In the case of Ceylon, the proportion of women to men amongst unskilled labor migrants was consistently above 60%, and it showed less fluctuation. The point I'd like to make is that to many contemporary observers in the 1930s, it looked as though Indian and Chinese migration to Southeast Asia would resume and continue and intensify. Few could see in 1936 or 37 that it would soon come to a grinding halt. If the trends of the post-depression recovery had continued, if you permit me of counterfactual, the proportion of Malaya's population of Indian origin might well have risen from an eighth to a quarter, and the Chinese population looked set to become an overall majority on the peninsula. This very real prospect, in fact, is what underlay many Malay nationalist fears of being swamped in their own land. But it never came to pass. For most people who lived through them, the changes of the 1930s did not initially appear decisive. The Depression, with its bouts of unemployment and deflation, its new controls on migration, seemed more like a harsh setback than a lasting shift. It was only in hindsight, after the Second World War, that these cracks in the web connecting all these lives around the Bay of Bengal came to seem like a permanent reversal. Reflecting on the circular migration of the 1920s and 30s, Mr. Palaniswamy insisted to me, and this was from an interview I did myself, that not one single person came here with the idea that they'd marry, settle down. They just wanted to earn money for a couple of years and go back. When I met him in 2007, he had been in Malaya for over 70 years. He told that story as if it was an accident. In his story, as in so many others, there arises a sense of almost something accidental and unplanned in the outcome of migrant trajectories. Something very fundamental changed in the possibilities of mobility around the Bay in the 1920s and 30s, and that change really started to set in after the Depression. Because while markets recovered after the Depression, a shift in political structures and ideologies refigured the relationship between India and Southeast Asia, and between the different communities and ethnic groups that lived around and across the Bay of Bengal. Indian and Chinese populations in Southeast Asia now found themselves the target of a rising tide of local nationalism in Burma and Malaya and throughout the region. Young local men blamed immigrants when they found their paths to employment or the colonial administration blocked, their prospects as entrepreneurs limited. Through eye and ear, wrote one sympathetic British observer, the Burman is continuously and acutely made aware of the alien control of the business activities of the country, of the steady infiltration of immigrant workers. This was written in the early 1930s. Rising awareness of inequality provoked competing claims of entitlement. The shock of the Depression sharpened the debates that had started in the 1920s about who belonged where in this mobile world. And now these were no longer abstract or confined to newspaper columns. Much more was at stake. Resentment of Indian immigration across the Bay was mirrored by an increasing Indian nationalist hostility to emigration. And that's a side of the story that is often neglected. Indian writers and politicians denounced the continued movement of Indian laborers to lands where they were not wanted, and where their humiliation would bring shame upon the Indian nation. The Congress's Searchlight newspaper lamented in 1938 the resumption of Malayan emigration after the Depression. India, they argued, risked becoming the great suppliers general of black coolies for European plantations. Indians would be treated as mere beasts and denied all rights and privileges, economic as well as political, that belong to other emigrants or settlers, be their skin black or white. The writer stated categorically that emigrants, Indian emigrants, do not go of their own accord, but are invited, persuaded, coaxed, and cajoled. If Indian workers overseas could not live in dignity, these journalists suggested, they should not go at all. If need be, the state should intervene to prevent them from emigrating, for their own protection and for the protection of India's reputation abroad. At the same time, as John Kelly and Martha Kaplan has shown, Indian nationalist commentators took a harsh view of the colonial born, discouraging them from returning to India, distancing the citizens of the future nation from the coolies overseas. The Bay of Bengal was crossed over and over again, but it was the land that underpinned the politics of belonging. The increasing territorial integration within India or Burma or Malaya only heightened the lack of political integration around the ocean's rim, even as economic and cultural connections flourished. Partha Chatterjee writes in his recent book of the normative acceptance over a wide spectrum of political opinion of the nation-state as the universally normal, legitimate form of the modern state during the 20s and 30s. And what strikes me is that even within the British Empire, colonial administrators and nationalist politicians alike began to act according to these norms. In 1930, the Indian economist Lanka Sundaram argued that the government of India should use India's membership of the League of Nations as a means of retaliation and arbitration in the case of unjust treatment of her nationals overseas. And by overseas, he meant other parts of the British Empire. He was talking about Burma and Malaya as much as South Africa. What is striking is the suddenness with which mobility around the Bay of Bengal came to an abrupt halt in the late 1930s. To put it another way, the Bay was internationalized even before the collapse of imperial rule. The Indian and Malayan governments conducted bilateral negotiations on immigration from 1937, well through the Second World War. The question of Indian immigration was central to the development of Burmese nationalism in the 1930s, and the control of further immigration was a key goal of the demand for Burma's separation from India, which occurred in 1937. The Indo-Burmese Agreement on Immigration, which was finally signed in 1941, set very strict limits on further migration of Indians to Burma. For the first time in a century, Indian migrants in Burma were politically, juridically in a foreign country. And this happened to them literally overnight. And there are so many petitions in the archives from Chettiars in Burma, for example, putting things in just that way, that overnight we find ourselves in a foreign country. In 1938, the government of India quite abruptly banned all further labor migration to Malaya and to Ceylon the following year. The Indian government believed that Indian migrants could never really be free laborers. And now they responded by trying to prevent them from leaving India at all. So what migration did continue to Malaya in the late 1930s was repeat migration, or the migration of those who went through family contacts rather than official recruitment. Moving towards a conclusion, the Bay of Bengal as a region fragmented with remarkable speed from the late 1930s and obviously during the Second World War. Patterns of migration that had developed over a century came to an abrupt halt. Lest I give the impression of taking a romanticized view of this, let me be clear that the end of this world of circular labor migration around the Bay marked the end of a world that was built on violence and coercion and cultural loss as much as on cosmopolitanism or cultural contact. The nationalization of the Bay emerged in many ways in reaction to an imperial world in which lives were mobile but cheap. The Bay of Bengal's imperial world of specialist migration, labor migration, had permitted its own margins of freedom for families in search of fortune or to avert catastrophe. But when these margins narrowed legally and politically in the 30s and 40s, it was at least in part to secure what many at the time felt was a much greater freedom, and that is the political rights of citizens of free nations and the rights to livelihood that these new nations would provide. What Hannah Arendt spoke of as the right to have rights. But the new order of things left many people and many communities marooned and out of place. In his writing on ideas of Asia, Prasenjit Dwara differentiates, I think helpfully, between the relatively unplanned or evolutionary emergence of an area of interaction and interdependence, and the more active, often ideologically driven, political process of creating a region. Relatively unplanned or evolutionary emergence of an area of interaction, the more active, ideologically driven process of creating a nation. The latter is what Douara calls a process of regionalization. To put it in the broadest terms, the Bay of Bengal was a region in the first of Douara's censors and never in the second. And through the revolutions in sovereignty of the mid-20th century, many of these pressures were brought to bear on these more informal interactions from trade to migration. The Bay of Bengal remained a family space and a sacred space. Within individual family networks, mobility continued well past the 1940s, but fresh migration came to a virtual standstill until the 1980s. And the Bay of Bengal as a public sphere, in the sense that it was in the 1920s and 30s, fragmented altogether by the 1950s. In South Asia and in South Asian studies, the region came to be defined very much in subnational terms, and in terms of language above all. The political context for this lies in Indian federalism and came to the fore during the debate over the reorganization of states in the 1950s. The 1955 States Reorganization Commission's report emphasized the need to balance linguistic homogeneity with greater interplay of different regional cultures. But what strikes me is that in its extensive discussion of whether or not there is a distinct Tamil cultural region, its authors saw no purpose by the 1950s to even mention the fact that there was a million-strong Tamil diaspora overseas outside the boundaries of the Indian nation state. Discussions of regionalism were very much territorialized. And in a similar way, in Malaya, the question of migration became a question of minorities and their quest for citizenship. By contrast, in modern Southeast Asia and correspondingly in Southeast Asian studies, the region has been defined most commonly in a statist, supranational sense, and specifically refer to the states that make up the Military Political Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN, formed in 1967. In this case, the project of regionalization was so far-reaching that it marginalized scholarly and public awareness of the more informal, unplanned regions of interaction, including those that continued to tie Southeast Asia to South Asia. Let me conclude, as I conclude the book, Crossing the Bay of Bengal, by suggesting that the Bay of Bengal's long history of migration and connectedness does in some senses continue to reverberate, and in many ways has become more relevant in the last 10 years than it was for most of that heyday from the 1950s to the 1980s, when trade and migration across the bay were at a low ebb. The Bay of Bengal is once again undergoing a relatively unplanned process of economic and cultural interaction, even if this is not once again in any way matched in the political or the institutional sphere. Migration around the bay is on the rise again and has been since the 1980s. Some of this migration follows very old patterns and very old routes. Old port cities around the bay, the port cities precisely those that are on that map, are resuming prominence, having been forgotten for a lot of the second half of the 20th century. Places like Sitwe in Burma and small ports from Cuddalore down to Nagapattinam in Tamil Nadu are undergoing a revival in the context, of course, of strategic competition in the Indian Ocean. In Tamil port towns, young men migrate to the Middle East or Southeast Asia, and they are mobile again like their grandparents, after their parents underwent a more sedentary period. And this generational shift is something that really strikes me. So that in retrospect, the period from the 40s to the 70s might appear as much an interruption as a total rupture.
Thank you very much, Sunil. To just kick off our conversation with you, on the one hand, I think what you do with this presentation, but also with the book, is to work across our givens of area studies, which is to sort of take South Asian studies and Southeast Asian studies and get these two bodies of scholarship, but also in effect the sort of remit of their studies as sort of in a way, you know, working across the artificiality of it. Mm. But the other that is interesting to me was captured in the statement you made, which comes up in the second part of what what you find distinctive about the history of this region in the interwar period, which is where you said nature can be learned through labor, where you quote someone saying nature can be learned through labor. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about how specifically sort of environmental history also comes in, because if we are talking about a reframing in one way of you know sort of working across that artificiality, it's also your work also speaks in a certain way to the reopening of the field to bring in histories of the environment, but also in your earlier work as histories of science, specifically medicine, to speak you know more generally within within sort of you know bring it within a single remit, so to speak, a single analytic frame. So I was wondering if you would say a little bit more.
Absolutely. I mean, I think there's one tradition of imperial environmental history which I certainly found illuminating, but I think I was trying to do something different. That tradition shows that the British Empire, and most of it is on the British Empire, was in itself a sort of mobile laboratory. And this is work, you know, Richard Grove's work, of course, on colonial environmentalism. Actually, the main actors in that story are scientists. Very mobile scientists who have this comparative connective perspective. And I think that is a very good way of writing interregional history. If you see these botanists, for example, traveling around the Indian Ocean collecting information and developing a comparative framework. What I was trying to do was something slightly different, which was in a sense to think of these migrants as themselves participants in a very fundamental transformation of environmental history, not only in an instrumental sense, but also in an experiential sense. So the way that environmental history crept into my book was actually from the micro rather than from the macro, which is that I noticed that in a lot of the sources that I was reading, some of them coroner's court records, some of them oral histories, migrants were talking about the land. They were talking about the landscape. They were talking about changes in the landscape as one of the chief ways in which they narrate their experience of crossing the sea. And in some ways, there is a sense that the sea is actually absent from these narratives. This is not the conventional story of oceanic history where we're dealing with traditionally seafaring communities that are developing these connections, riding the monsoon winds. You know, a lot of these are agriculturalists in India, and they go and work on plantations in Malaya. And what they do in the course of that migration is to, in a sense, participate in, often unwillingly, the massive deforestation of the Malay Peninsula, that's transformation into monoculture landscape. So I think the point that I'm trying to make is that actually the environmental history or the history of science in a broader sense can help us write into interregional histories and to break down some of these area studies boundaries from both ends of the lens. You can do it in a macroscopic scale. You can do it in terms of the history of environmental change around the Indian Ocean as a whole. You can do it by focusing on the history of science story, which I think has been well done. It's been done since the 1990s. But perhaps we can also do it in that intersection between what I suppose is conventionally called labor history and environmental history. And that's where I found the American tradition of writing environmental history, which is quite new to me. It's not something I encountered until relatively recently, opened up perhaps certain avenues that we haven't yet thought about in terms of South or Southeast Asian studies.
Thank you, Doc. Sorry to interrupt you, the Harvard Trade Institute. So I have three very quick questions. The first is on the idea of financial flows and what happened to the towns of Nagapattinam, Madras. And so, I mean, I'm thinking with partly selfishly my own project in terms of what happened to the interiors. And two, on that day, with the war, when rice exports stopped from Burma, the sea became almost this source of interruption. It interrupted the flow, and so I'm interested in, as much as it brought in circulation, what interruption did to the interiors, both in terms of Rangoon or Burma, as well as Madras, the presence more broadly. The third question was following on the previous question. When you looked at nature's labor, that was really interesting. And thinking with some recent work on anthropology, and Anupadhyay's work on Tamil genealogies, proverbs, sayings with the land, I'm wondering how, and water was something that was really, that's been worked on, that income problems really closely, and it's really striking that the sea is then absent completely from that narrative.
Yes.
And so I'm interested in seeing how these things are refigured in human spaces from Malaya.
Those are great questions. The financial flows certainly are interrupted quite sharply in the 1930s, and you can see that from the history of the Chettiars, for example. And they are essentially dispossessed in Burma in a number of stages, first in the late 1930s with a set of colonial legislation, and then much more decisively after Burmese independence. And actually their claims for compensation are going through the courts well into the 1940s and 50s. And you can see the impact on Chettinad deep into the interior. Even today, I mean, there are these sort of semi-abandoned towns where all of these Chettiar merchants from Malaya and Burma built their mansions in the early 20th century. And most of those are now uninhabited because it took a couple of generations for the Chettiar community to find other avenues, which of course they did, whether that's migration to the United States or, you know, involvement in the urban economy of Madras. But nevertheless, you see an interruption. I think you see a similar interruption, probably dating from an earlier period, to Tamil Muslim merchant networks. Because in many ways, it's the Tamil Muslim shipping merchants that are the first to be squeezed out by the British India Steam Navigation Company in the late 19th century. And yet, I think there are continuities too. If you actually look at who is most mobile after colonialism, it's the Tamil Muslim, the petty traders, the merchants. They maintain their connections with India much more than, say, the rubber plantation workers of Malaysia. It's those plantation workers who end up, in their own terms, marooned in Malaysia, who, through the passage of time, lose their kinship networks. You know, many of them have never been to India by the time they're in the second generation. That's not true of the Tamil Muslims, and that's also true, sort of reflected in the gender balance, in that the Tamil Muslim community of Singapore, Penang, and most of the port cities is male for a much longer period. And that then leads me, in a sense, to this your second and wonderful question, which is one of the chief differences is, of course, the Tamil Muslims are traditionally a maritime community, and indeed they had been crossing the Bay of Bengal for centuries. And in many ways, they have adapted best to the resurgence of trade around the Bay of Bengal. And you see them, you know, the revival of smaller ports in Tamil Nadu today, the revival of shipbuilding in places like Rameshwaram. Tamil Muslims are often sort of at the vanguard of that, and their financial flows, I think, are important, even if they're beneath the radar as far as high-level policy is concerned. Those small networks, I think, still matter. They matter even in Burma to this day. If you go to somewhere like Mulmain, you see that they were in abeyance for 30 or 40 years, but actually there are still Tamil Muslims in Mulmain who are talking about reconnecting their lives with South India. I love the idea of the sea as the source of interruption. I mean, I couldn't have put it better myself. And one of the things that's very striking in the Second World War is that it's probably the first time that mobility around the Bay of Bengal, whether of goods or of people, really does stop. It happens briefly during the First World War, but not for a very long period of time. And it is that cessation of mobility that means that, you know, you've got people literally trying to carve a path through the jungle in terms of those refugees who are walking back from Burma to India, and others have to sort of make do. So, for example, you have all of these stories that, you know, Tim Harper has worked on in the Malayan case of actually, in some ways, the war improved the nutrition of certain Tamil plantation workers in Malaya because for the first time they had access to small plots of land. Plots of land which had been abandoned by fleeing Europeans, and they formed their own communities in the interior. Of course, the interruption of rice has catastrophic consequences in Bengal. And I think that's actually one of the most important explanations for why that trade then never revives after the war. It's because of the scar of that experience that, of course, the Indian state is so committed to self-sufficiency in the 1940s, as are so many other states around the Bay of Bengal's rim. And I think that memories of the Depression and the war are at least as important as the drawing of new political borders in explaining why the Bay never became an economic unit, because its chief trade in rice sort of dwindles to nothing by the 50s because of all of the, you know, both projects of self-sufficiency and then kind of Cold War era bilateral relationships, whether that's PL 480 flows between the United States and South Asia, or, you know, the Chinese start barter agreements for rice with Sri Lanka. I mean, these things happen. And I think actually it's that sea as interruption in the war that shapes what follows. Tamil genealogies and proverbs, very interesting. I mean, one of the things that strikes me is exactly the complete absence of the sea from so many of the discussions. The discussions of water are usually discussions of rivers, or they're discussions of rainfall, and not really discussions of the sea. And what strikes me is that those proverbs move over to Malaya almost wholesale. This is a very interesting collection of Tamil proverbs from the Malayan plantations, and this was done by an amateur ethnographer in the 1990s. And she finds that actually the harvest songs have moved over in the same way, even though the seasonality of labor in Malaya is so different. And Tamil women on the plantations are singing harvest songs even when Malaya, they have no access to land at all, and they're actually tapping rubber. So I think that, you know, the transference and the translation of those cosmologies and those worldviews is something that, you know, much more work, I think, could be done on.
First of all, picking up on what you were saying about the revival of the trade within Bay of Bengal, is it not the case, I mean, since the Second World War, that all these issues have been and now are seen in strategic terms? I mean, the revival of Sikkim, for example, is seen primarily in terms of strategic rivalry between India and Burma. There are new sites to add to those that you have. So that's one point I'd like to make. I'd like to see how you connect that also with the strategic perception of Chinese pressure in the border areas.
Sure.
And much of the relationship between India and Burma in the last 40, 50 years has focused on their common reaction to insurgency or potential insurgency in the border areas. So there's been a lot of cooperation between the Indian and Burmese governments. Long-term Chinese strategic plans, which clearly involve some kind of possibility of military pressure on the northern Bangladesh and on the narrow cut-off point between India's northeast and the mainland. And all that is seen within the same sort of parameters as the understanding of the way in which the Bay of Bengal is going. Bay of Bengal is no longer an Indian lake. It's a Chinese lake as well. My other question, observation on this is, you don't mention indentured labour at all, yet some of the phenomena of this migration to Malaya, circular migration, was characteristic of at least part of the indentured labour to the island, things which were published last year, which is a personal memoir of the American scholars. Grandmother, who unusually gone on her own, is indentured labour to Guyana. But analyzing those statistics, there were quite a lot of people who came back after their 5-year term and then went back again. And my question is one of ignorance, really. To what extent did official encouragement of migration play an important part, up to when, in the migration of towns to Southeast Asia?
Thank you very much for those questions. I think the strategic revival of the Bay of Bengal is clearly strategic factors are behind a lot of these port projects in particular, more perhaps than economic connections. I think that's led to a rather interesting historical narrative that you get in strategic studies as opposed to in Indian Ocean history, where what strikes me, and I was struck by a speech actually that Hillary Clinton made when she was Secretary of State. She made this speech in Chennai in 2011 about the Bay of Bengal, about the sort of resurgence of connectedness. And she talks about India's ancient presence in Southeast Asia, and she talks about the future. But the 20th century is completely absent from that story of connection. I think you get that. The idea, you know, Hambantota was where the Arab ships came centuries ago, that there's this recreation of a particular kind of Indian Ocean historical narrative that skips over most of the colonial period, that these are ancient connections which now in the interests of Chinese friendship with Sri Lanka, for example, are being revived. And I think that the way in which the Indian Ocean's deep history has entered into even popular newspaper articles about these new ports, that, you know, are these ancient connections or are these very much 21st century strategic rivalries, is interesting from my point of view as a historian, because most of them do skip over modern history very quickly. It's about sort of connecting a received and often very approximate notion of an ancient Indian Ocean with a future-oriented analysis about what these ports are going to do. The strategic pressure on border areas, I think one thing that's happening, though obviously to nothing like the extent of the South China Sea, is that maritime borders are becoming more and more contested. And for example, you know, there have been these Sri Lanka and India have disputes over fisheries, for example, which could escalate in different ways. At the same time, you have the maritime border dispute ongoing between Burma, Bangladesh, and India to do partly that's to do with economic interests and possible oil and natural gas reserves in the Bay of Bengal and the parceling up of those lots. But also has to do, I think, with strategic rivalries. That sense of the border under threat, I think, is spreading to the maritime border as much as, not as much as the land border, but as an extension of what is going on in other parts of the region. Indentured labor is interesting. I mean, one of the things that struck me doing this work, which was somewhat contrary to what I expected to find, is that indentured labor accounts for at most 10% of the migration to Malaya. Malaya is often thought of as one of the colonies of indentured labor, which it certainly was to begin with in the 1870s and 1880s, but that is very quickly displaced by the so-called Kangani system, which was always used in Ceylon, which was essentially a system of labor recruiters where existing plantation workers would go back to their villages and recruit men on commission. So I think indenture is part of the beginnings of this story, but very, very quickly fades away. And one of the questions is how similar or dissimilar indenture is to what takes its place in Malaya, which is a debt-based system where advances are given to laborers, and which in many ways is not very different in practice to what contracts of indenture stipulated, as far as workers were indentured for as long as until they paid their advances back, as well as fixed periods of time. So actually, the book that you mentioned is very interesting in suggesting that actually even those earlier indentured migrations had some level of circularity to them, that people would sort of come and go. I think one of the differences, of course, is both scale and proximity. I mean, Sri Lanka in particular, but Malaya and Burma were so very much closer to India that I think that circulation was on an altogether greater scale. Official encouragement of migration to Malaya is very important until the Depression. Then you start to get official discouragement of migration to Malaya, which is not to say that the migration stops, but official help for migration stops. From 1907, for example, the colonial state of Malaya collects a levy from the planters, which they use to then pay migrants' passages and to maintain the emigration depot in Nagapattinam and in Madras. So there's a lot, you know, the role of the colonial state is very important, though it's not conflict-free. I mean, I've been struck in doing the archival work for this project on how fractious things are between the government of Madras and the government of Malaya, in terms of each of them trying to protect a certain constituency's interests. So the government of Madras is quite often intervening on behalf of the rights of Indian migrant workers in Malaya, whereas the government of Malaya was, at least as perception has it, largely pursuing the planters' interests. So even bilaterally within the empire, you have these conflicts, and they become quite sharp by the 30s.
Could we take a few questions?
Sure.
This is really nice talk. Just an observation on your larger paper. What one really gets a sense that from today's presentation is that that this migration is a free-flowing migration, and where I would kind of push you a bit towards to actually differentiate layers of migration. Where actually, so there are like checking of merchant traders who are going, then there are like contract labor,
sure.
Then of course the container system under which labor goes. So I try to push you one like that is the one direction. The other direction will be towards to kind of see different kinds of economies that Burma itself was a rice cultivating economy, while Penang and Malaysia were much more towards a kind of indigenous plantation economies, and while including Ceylon. So I think if you can really differentiate within these kind of different orders of migration, different kinds of economies, then actually give a very clear kind of picture. One thing, of course, is the is about that how these things actually comes to seizes. So while depression actually is very important for the kind of for a kind of stoppage for the Chechens to kind of migrate, but I think the war kind of really becomes an important issue for the laborers, because the fear of Japanese attacking this eastern part actually is very much felt by the laborers. So they're kind of coming back, while the individual conflict shows that trains packed with laborers are actually coming during the World War. So I think so there are like different layers of migration coming back. And also related to this is actually, which is also clear as our picture of the kind of space, different kinds of space or different kind of imagination that actually circulates or comes up or emerges within these colonies. I think so there are like different kinds of imagination which are going on. So while literary and cultural or newspaper thing will be much more kind of literary production, while there is a kind of cinematic different kind of which much more linked to the liberal direction. I mean, you come up with songs like "Mere Piya Gaya Bhool," "Once I Had These Things." So there are like different layers of cultural interaction and cultural imagination. I think it would be interesting to kind of open up and kind of be receptive to these differentiations.
That's a wonderful comment. I think the layers of migration is a very important point, and is also those layers are different in each of the cases that I've talked about. Burma is the contrast, and I think you pointed to why it is a sharp contrast, because it's not a plantation economy. And one of the things that's striking about Burma in comparison to Malaya and Sri Lanka, on the other hand, is just what a wide diversity of occupations that the laborers go from India to occupy. Whereas in Malaya, something like 80% of all migration is contract labor migration. Of those, the vast majority are working on plantations. Whereas in Burma, you have a much more finely differentiated, both rural and urban, and in different parts of the country, you have the presence of Indian migrant workers much more in sort of small-scale industries, for example, like rice milling, like all of the ancillary developments that come out of the expansion of rice cultivation in Burma. The other contrast with Burma is Indian capital. Indian capital does not play a major role in Malaya or in Sri Lanka. Again, because they're plantation economies, it is primarily European capital. Whereas in Burma, that was by far the biggest field for the Chettiars, and they financed the expansion of Burmese rice cultivation. So clearly the experience of the Chettiars is fundamentally different from that of working class migrants to, say, the Malayan plantations or even to different parts of Burma. And I think that those differentiations not only need to be emphasized in terms of a typology, but also become politically very significant. So, you know, one of the questions is, why was there so little cohesion within the Indian diasporic public sphere in Malaya in the 1930s? And, you know, partly that is because this was such a fragmented population, and that the Central Indian Association of Malaya, which develops in the 1930s, is very much an urban traders and merchants sort of association with absolutely no connection with the plantations, and largely actually not Tamil speaking. So it's the linguistic differentiation is also something that comes into these place. And I think that, you know, trying to draw a very finely drawn picture of different types of migration within this broader economic system of migrant labor and circulation of capital, and also the fact that as those circulations are squeezed in the 1930s, as you point out, they have very different impacts on different people. Even the wartime experience is so different in Burma and Malaya. So in Burma, that fear of a Japanese invasion leads literally hundreds of thousands of people to flee on foot. In Malaya, that isn't really an option. So what you have is more a sort of rooting of that population in place, including those who would never imagine that they would stay in Malaya, those who had sort of subsisted on this sort of constant circulation. And I think that also then explains, if we're extrapolating further, the very different forms of Tamil politics in Sri Lanka, Malaya, and Burma after the 1940s, because they certainly don't take the same sort of trajectory. And I think that's also rooted in their particular histories of migration.
Thank you for talking. How did the Bay of Bengal region fit in with the large region of the Indian Ocean, and did the specificity of the Bay of Bengal region, I mean, there's a whole question to the sensibilities of the Indian Ocean, which is often termed the region of the overarching.
I think the Bay of Bengal is in many ways connected with that wider Indian Ocean world. I think it is much more intensively connected within itself than the wider Indian Ocean world is, and I think that the key differentiating factor is actually migration. It is the sheer scale of human mobility that takes place around the Bay of Bengal. You know, I'm often asked, well, what about the Arabian Sea and significant Indian migration to East Africa and the Middle East? And those were clearly very significant, politically, culturally significant, but a fraction of the scale of this migration that's going on, which is why I think that the Bay of Bengal makes sense as an arena, as long as one is attentive to two things. One is that it was, one is hardly trying to replace rigid area studies boundaries by saying there is this clearly defined region that is the Bay of Bengal. It is more a space of interaction which ebbs and flows. And so, for example, I think if I was writing a history just of the 1950s and 60s, I certainly wouldn't choose to take the Bay of Bengal as my region of analysis, because in fact it would largely be a story of the ebbing away of connections that once were. But if you take a longer sweep of time, and in my case I focus mostly in the book on 1850 to 1950, I think the intensity of those connections is what makes it meaningful. As long as one thinks about its connections with the wider Indian Ocean region, but also with the South China Sea. I mean, I think one of the things that's most interesting about the Bay of Bengal is it is where that circuit meets the other oceanic circuit, which South Asianists, of course, don't usually have reason to pay attention to, which is Chinese migrant and capital networks. And remember that Malaya is striking because it is the number one destination in the world for Chinese emigration overseas. More than any other part of the world, Chinese migrants go to Malaya, and it's number two or three for Indian emigration after Burma and Sri Lanka. So it really is, to the extent that that's seen as the eastern frontier of the Bay of Bengal, I think, and certainly in the book, I found it impossible not to then also think about the South China Sea. So one could either go articulate this with a wider Indian Ocean history, or, you know, just as interesting, and from my point of view, perhaps more exciting, would be to sort of link it up with the work that's being done on the overseas Chinese.
Thanks, that's a lovely talk. And I want to ask you about a point which you alluded to in response to one of the earlier questions, and really sort of, you know, maybe think about what happens in the period after the 40s.
Yes.
Especially in relation to Sri Lanka, which in some ways strikes me as being a fairly peculiar case even within the Bay of Bengal region, particularly on the question of migration.
Mm-hmm.
And even on culture, and I suppose subjective experiences of migrants. Because, you know, Sri Lanka is the only, Sri Lanka is, of course, the first democracy in South Asia. Universal and franchise starts Sri Lanka in 1931. But it's also very peculiar that maybe the only democracy in the world which has actually disenfranchised a very substantial population of the territory, which is plantation land workers, which is one of the mid-50s. And of course, many of them were repatriated back to India in 1964. And you know, part of their sort of, you know, just the way that the circularity works is, you know, tied with the political experience of Sri Lanka, but also the culture. Right, because many of the plantation Tamils initially politically supported the more mainstream Tamil parties.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, the Tamils always felt themselves to be culturally much superior to plantation Tamils. Right? And there's a very significant, in terms of literary production, in terms of music, and so on. They just felt that they were at the top end of the cultural spectrum,
mm-hmm.
and really saw themselves as the flame keepers of the old sort of ancient Tamil glory and so on. whereas the plantation workers were seen primarily as there was a very strong sense of cultural superiority. So I just wonder, how much of that was also part of this experience that that communities which were earlier and perhaps more deeply embedded because of much, much earlier ways of plantation going back to the important period. And their relationship and reception of micro communities, especially once the boom period of the 30s passes, once things start getting tough, this relationship between various generations of migrants any thoughts you have about that?
That's a great question. There's an interesting parallel in Malaysia. Very different political history, and obviously it's so much less traumatized a history that it's not necessarily directly comparable, but you get that with the Tamil Muslims, long settled Tamil Muslims in Malaya, who went in the 19th century or prior, many of whom intermarried with local women to form a distinctive and very elite community, who again saw themselves as both Tamil and Malay and Muslim in quite a, in the 19th century, that was quite a natural claim for their intellectual leadership. So many of these figures that are, again, in the area studies tradition, seen as sort of leading Malay figures like Munshi Abdullah in the 19th century, are of Tamil descent, mixed Malay Tamil families, and quite happily sort of move between. When you start to get the mass migration, not just of Tamil Hindus to the plantations, but also of working class Tamil Muslims, you get a fundamental divergence that happens. And the form it takes in Malaysia, which is different from Sri Lanka, is that you start to get that old assimilated elite actually claiming that they are Malay. What they do is they cut off, instead of claiming sort of superior cultural capital, as Tamils, they throw their lot in with what is by then sort of emerging Malay intellectual and political elite. And this community that had been known as the Jawi Peranakan, they actually apply collectively to change the census category in 1911 to Malay. Those politics are long buried, but they're actually resurfacing now. And within Malaysian politics, this question of a reopening of those hierarchies and those boundaries, I think, is quite an interesting one. A non-South Asian example, you find the same with the overseas Chinese communities. For example, the Straits Chinese of Singapore, once you start to get mass migration from the mainland. I think it's the particular political trajectory which starts with 1931 and democracy that makes Sri Lanka then such a distinctive case from then on. But also the longevity of the Jaffna Tamil community is even greater than the Tamil Muslims of the Malay Peninsula. But I think that layering of different migrations clearly seems to take rather different political turns once the politics of identity and representation in the 20th century become widespread.
Thanks for your presentation. We discussed a bit about the political traditions of the urban traders in Malaya, the Indian, or the Tamil. But I was wondering more about the laborers in the plantations. What sort of political traditions were they exposed to? I would think that the Communist Party in Malaya, which is, becomes really big part of what is already there. So do they form, are they being integrated into this Communist Party in Malaya, and do they bring political traditions back to India?
I think there are two really important waves of politicization on the plantations. The first is not related to the Communist Party so much as the self-respect movement and Periyar Veeramaswamy. So the first major Indian political figure to tour the plantations of Malaya is Periyar in 1929 when he makes a visit to Malaya. And that has a really sort of catalyzing effect on plantation politics. It is primarily then a politics of social and caste reform on the plantations. It starts to turn some of the plantation workers against the Kanganis, who tend to be higher caste foremen it tends to spark a set of politics around temple entry on the plantations of Malaya, the division of the barracks and the labor lines, whether they should be segregated on caste lines, and all of those things. And it starts to allow for some possibility of integration between the urban political leaders and the countryside. It is really through Periyar's followers in Malaya and Singapore that that starts to happen. And really it's these self-respecters that are the first to make large-scale political speeches on the plantations, and also their theater troupes travel the length and breadth of Malaya, putting on social reform-related plays, which also then do start to provoke a certain discourse of rights. And you start to see an increasing number, in the archives, for example, you see an increasing number of petitions from plantation workers to the Labor Commissioner, talking about the violation of their rights and clearly deploying some of these new languages of politics which are coming to the plantations. In the 30s, you get a significant radicalization of politics on the plantations, and that starts to happen from about 1936, 37. Strikingly, it happens when migration decreases. So what you have is a slightly more settled sort of plantation population by the late 1930s, and that's when you start to get one wing of the urban political leadership radicalized, often members of the Communist Party, or at least affiliated with the Communist Party, who are then going and talking on the plantations, and that's when colonial intelligence services, for example, start to get worried about propaganda that they find circulating, Tamil language bills and posters and all of this. And in 1941, you have the Klang strikes, which are the biggest plantation strikes that had ever been seen in Malaya by quite some way. And of course, this is the time when the British Empire is increasingly gearing up for a Pacific war as well as the war that's being fought. And so this was brutally suppressed. But nevertheless, all of the investigations into the strike show that these networks were starting to circulate in the plantations. The war interrupts them quite significantly, of course, because first of all, the Communist Party was underground for most of the war. What happens after the war is really that the Communist Party of Malaya, which for fortuitous rather than ideological reasons is Chinese dominated, tries to make some links with the plantations in Malaya, starts to make some headway, but not in any large scale way. There are more strikes on the plantations in 1946 and 1947, which are not directly linked to the Communist Party, to the best of our knowledge. And the British are absolutely obsessed with the idea that the Communists will infiltrate the plantations. And so there is a very strong sort of counterinsurgency on the plantations that starts even before the emergency is declared in 1948, where you have essentially the British in Malaya cultivate a generation of anti-communist leaders, give them a fair amount of authority. And so from the late 1940s onwards, the plantation workers' unions in Malaya are quite staunchly anti-communist, which is not to say that there isn't the other tradition which is there and which clearly had some traction at certain moments.
Have you seen much more
Great, thank you. It is a constantly changeable narrative, and even sort of watching migration migrate within the archive of British India is very striking. Migration is the responsibility of about 7 or 8 different government departments from 1871 to the 1920s, ends up, you know, first it's revenue and agriculture, it ends up being commerce and industry. Eventually there's an emigration department only by the 1930s. In the 40s there's an Indians overseas department. So even at the sort of Indian government level in Calcutta and then Delhi, there is a very striking sort of changeability, but it's a constantly changeable narrative. And one of the things that strikes me is actually that even plantation workers start to use that in the 1920s. And this is one of the things that you see them appealing to different levels of government with their grievances. With, if not a fully worked out, at least some sort of implicit knowledge of that structure. So you see that sometimes they will send their telegrams to the protector of Indian immigrants in Malaya. Sometimes they will manage to get communications directly to the government of Madras. The general perception was that the government of Madras was the most active on the side of the laborers, more so than the government of India. So there was this sense that sort of going to the provincial level government would be the way to go. But that's never consistent. I mean, you see plenty of issues where the Madras government says, well, we need to encourage commerce, we need to not to upset, you know, the government of Malaya. And I think this is a constantly, as you put it, it's a very changeable narrative, and it's one that I think you can look at it from either from below or from above. I mean, there's an interesting administrative and archival history of this, but there is also a history of claims making of a certain kind on the part of plantation workers who have some awareness of these structures, and even the language that they use can even think of it as an incipient language of citizenship in terms of we are Indians overseas. Who are they addressing those claims to? That varies at different moments. I think that whole, the sort of, you know, the Furnival narrative of the plural society has shaped Southeast Asian history and Southeast Asian urban history to such a large extent, and I think it still remains perhaps the dominant narrative, particularly in the region. I mean, if you go to Singapore, that is still really how that story is told. I think there is probably a level, a macroscopic level, in which it has a lot of truth to it, and clearly there was a very segmented labor market. Clearly there was never complete, but there were forms of residential segregation. And yet I do think that these divisions are breaking down all the time, and that something like a vernacular cosmopolitanism in public culture does develop. And to some extent, traces of that are still present in the urban landscape of Southeast Asia, which is what makes their particular version of multiculturalism very different from those in many different parts of the world. I think that's rooted in a particular tradition. My point would always be that this vernacular cosmopolitanism doesn't bear that much resemblance to sort of, you know, political and cultural theories of cosmopolitanism. It was very often lived and not theorized. It was very often contradictory, and most of all, it was fragile. It could so often spill over into something else, depending on the political climate and the economic climate. And it was clearly open to a very heavy intervention on the part of the state in Malaya and Singapore from the 1940s onwards, and certainly after independence. You know, one could even see the Malaysian state since the 1970s or 80s sort of trying to fight in kind of rear guard action against those kinds of interactions, whether that's by, you know, banning shadow puppet performances or, you know, more strictly enforcing culinary segregation in public space. So I think it's an ongoing tussle, really, rather than an enduring kind of cosmopolitanism.
Yes,
just to really follow up to anyone on the question of indentured labour, I mean, it was clearly to the latter, the latter years of the indentured labour force, there was a big improvement in the conditions in which the indentured labourers were transported. Was in the kind of migration that you described, the kind of interventions that describe providing passage for town workers to Malaya, was there a conscious implementation of better conditions general verdict on indentured labour, which is a new form of slavery.
Yes.
And the slightly apologetic description of the way of statistics say, well, actually, the slave ships, such and such a percentage died, and indentured labour ships, a much smaller percentage died. Not a very convincing argument, but I'm not a very powerful argument in itself. But I wanted to ask you about that. And the second thing really is the kind of migration that has led to, over a century, led to the current problems in Arakan, the migration of Bengali-speaking Muslims from across a completely porous border into what was often vacant land in Arakan, the Rohingyas. There's a lot of contested statistics about this. And I don't know whether any official statistics were kept of this kind of migration. And this is clearly the legacy of that migration is clearly a very live one today. Among the most poisonous of migration issues that the Burmese government and the international community are facing.
Absolutely. Briefly on indentured labour, conditions do improve in the first or second decade of the 20th century. What you see is that mortality rates, both on the journey and on the plantations themselves, peak in the late 1880s, early 1890s. And from then on, partly because of a humanitarian outcry, partly because of worry about political protest in India, you start to see the government of India taking a much greater interest in the mortality statistics themselves. And by the early 20th century, you start to see ranked lists of plantations in Malaya according to their mortality rates and temporary suspensions of migration to particular plantations where those conditions were seen as particularly harsh. The sanitary regulation of the journey is something which, of course, does start to happen in the 20th century and is related to the much broader regulation of, for example, the Hajj pilgrimage, which you see both the British and Dutch empires starting to try to treat as a public health issue from the late part of the 19th century. And Eric Taglioso's book on the Hajj from Southeast Asia says very interesting things about this. So you do start to have medical officers on board ships, slightly more regular inspections, certain restrictions about minimum levels of space. And clearly that does lead to a decline in mortality, though at the same time you have plenty of episodes in the archives of horrendous conditions persisting well into the 20th century. This is a quotation from really quite late on, 1917 or something, where you have a British officer saying, well, there's no point exporting labour to Malaya if they die within 2 years of getting there. The wastage is too much. It was very much the kind of calculus that perhaps one is used to from studying slave societies. And this is, you know, well into the 20th century. So I think the overall picture is clearly one of improvement around the turn of the 20th century, but all sorts of abuses or, you know, oppressions do continue within that particular system. The Arakan story is such an interesting one, I think, and also so revealing of the long-term legacies of mobility and immobility in this part of the world. The point is that because that was a porous boundary and regular, constant, largely overland movement, the colonial state paid no attention to it whatsoever, and there were very few statistics of the people moving back. The statistics were largely ship arrivals and departures by ship. The colonial state was much less concerned, apart from during the census where people were enumerated either within or outside the district of their birth. The kind of constant mobility is not something I don't know of very good statistics about mobility in that region. And its history is, of course, now so contested. But, of course, two things happen in the 1940s. One of them is that people who are traditionally mobile in terms of circulating migrant labor are often stopped from migrating. But at the same time, borders are drawn right in the middle of communities that are used to circulating. And of course, that Bengal-Burma borderland is precisely one of those spaces where all of the struggles for citizenship that the Rohingya and other communities as well in those borderlands have continued to wage, I think, as you say, it's one of the intractable and most violent, in this case, lingering problems of that migration, you know, alongside the Sri Lankan issue, which to some extent reached a conclusion with the end of the civil war, but which I think continues to have all sorts of ramifications. So those are probably the two issues, the Rohingya and the Sri Lankan Tamils, where this is more than a, you know, there's a major international issue that's coming out of this particular history of mobility across borders in the region.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you all for coming along, and thank you very much, Sunil, for taking the time
Thanks
to share your ideas and thoughts with us. Some of you, I hope, will join us for drinks in Fernandes and Wells. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you.